that you read from, you mentioned, you like name drop Nietzsche and Heidegger, and Champ in here also name drops Nietzsche. And we were talking before we were able to connect you on the laptop.
I heard.
Yeah. Oh, you were listening. So we were talking about how Champ is like a character who's able to combine, you know, a very highfalutin diction and bring in all these like Western, hyper like educated like worldview with sort of the language of the world of Portland and his neighborhood and his family. So I was wondering if you could speak to how you constructed his voice, I guess, and the language that he used.
So a couple of things, like my political self intended the voice to be a kind of protest against the idea that this kind of person is not as well-spoken as people might think. So a part of it is just me intentionally wanting to, it's almost even overdoing it to make him more articulate than other people would think. And then the other part of it is anyone who is forced to live in that kind of life and then also live in the college world has to be able to code switch. So one of the essays that I teach in my classrooms is an essay by James Baldwin called If Black English Isn't a Language, Then Tell Me What Is. And he's kind of making the case that black English should be respected as an English and not as a like sub-genre of language. And so a part of it is like trying to also make people respect that kind of my native, what I would say is my native kind of tongue.
So what were you concerned about in having to pursue both of those dialectics in alienating both the high and the low through making those moves?
Yeah. You're saying alienating like people who were looking for high diction and then people who were looking for the other?
Well, in some interviews you had talked about how in order to properly market it the way that you wanted to have it fit your scope, to not be presented as urban literature, even though the people that you most want it to read, or most want to read it, are people who you want to remember and empathize with your story. So how did you, I guess, address towing the line between the literary fiction and the target audience?
Well, I think one of the things I did is just not to kind of worry about them too much, just to write the thing that, that I would most want to read. And I know everyone says that in writing classes, like write what you, but I really did write what I wanted to read, because the other thing was maybe I don't have the breadth of kind of reading experience, but I didn't see a lot of places where I could, that I found that kind of stuff that I wanted to read. And not to say, I mean, I love a lot of writers, but not who do this kind of same thing. And even if they do, like, I didn't know anyone who did it from, like, a West Coast kind of perspective. So a lot of it was just listening to my friends and then listening to my professors and then just carrying that kind of language around with me and then not thinking, well, is this going to have an audience? Like, realistically, if I wanted an audience, I wouldn't have wrote this book.
You mentioned the West Coast, and you know, I was wondering how maybe this is not something that you thought about as you wrote the book, but I'm sure it's something that you've had to grapple with since its publication. The fact that this is set in Portland and sort of the national imagination of what Portland is not what's depicted in the story.
Yeah.
And, like how did you address that, either when writing it or sort of in the what you tell people after it's been writing?
Well, the good thing is that I never knew that Portland. So the national perspective on Portland is like completely lost to me. My community was black. I went to black schools. Everyone around me was, you know, so I'm not saying that I didn't see any people that weren't of color, but I didn't have that experience. So when people say like, gosh, this is a different kind of Portland, well, it's the only Portland that I know. I go back now and I see the other Portland, but I'm not writing about that time period, and I don't have familiarity with it because I left 12 years ago, so that is fairly new, that area of Portland that people you know, that is on the TV show. I haven't seen the TV show, but that's what they tell me.
So, you know, how about let's open it up if any of you have questions right now, and then we'll come back.
Yeah, sure.
And if anyone else have questions they want to, you might want to come here into the camera. You say, I know you're
sure.
Go for it.
Yeah.
Hi, Mitchell.
Hey.
One thing that struck me about the novel was the repeated idea of the importance of creating some kind of life story for these characters, or that they needed to sort of be memorable in some kind of way. There's a lot of talk about being legends, whether that's on the basketball court or selling drugs or playing dominoes or you know, even picking up women. Champ says at one point, you know, I fuck for stories.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm interested in, and what's struck me as interesting, is how, and it occurred to me how many of Champ's problems and also my own problems stem from this desire to create some kind of life story, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And my question is, you know, is Champ someone who's stuck in his own story, a character of his own creating who really can't sort of escape?
I think that's really astute, and I think that Champ is a person who is caught in his persona. Right, so he's created this personas for himself, and rarely does he step outside of those personas. And in the novel, on the rare occasion that he does, he's telling a reader who doesn't know him. So when he, you know, the meta kind of fictive parts of the novel is when he steps out and says, well, let me talk to you guys, who is an imaginary person, but he would never say that to his homeboy, so he's never able to do that in his actual, you know, the course of his day. And I think a lot of guys are like that, we kind of build these personas for ourselves, and they're reinforced in the community, and then we feel beholden to that kind of person in a way that's restrictive and maybe even damaging.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Any more questions?
Yeah, I was really interested when you were talking about code switching earlier. And I noticed the way that in the novel, Champ is always defining or specifying who the we is, like me and you or me and another character. Could you talk a little bit more about the ways that he presents himself in different scenarios and like how, you know, how true is that to like an African-American experience in Portland?
So I think the we... he's always trying to define the who's included, because he has to always figure out who his audience is to know how to speak to them. And, you know, not to get, I mean, I guess we're in an academic setting, so it doesn't matter, but, you know, Du Bois always talks about, or not always, has talked about the, what is it, double consciousness. And so the we that Champ is always is speaking of is constantly like imagining, well, who is this message for? Let me define this. Who am I speaking to? And then really it's really about what power does that person have over me or over, you know, over the narrator. So I think Champ is constantly trying to negotiate where he fits in the dynamic of power when he's communicating with someone. Like, when he's talking to his brothers, he can be more forceful. He recognizes that. When he's talking to the police, he has to acquiesce. He can't be, you know, he puts on a different kind of voice. He always talks about, I say things with honor. I want it to be deferential when I'm talking with him. So he recognizes when he has little power and when he has more power, or when he's maybe an equal when he's talking to his friends. And I think that's, you know, that's most people, but I think it's really important when you feel like you're part of the oppressed, any oppressed group, that you have to kind of watch your tongue a little more than someone else would.
Did you have a question about character?
Which question?
Oh, maybe about names.
yeah. Well, I mean, I noticed that many of your characters were named. Their names were quite poignant to the characters. Grace, Champ, Kanan, Jude, or maybe Judas.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I guess I am inclined to read that as intentional and was able to speak to that.
Yeah, so I'll tell you that Grace So I worked on this novel for 10 years plus, and for 9.5 of those years, Grace's name was Rhonda. And I was thinking there's no kind of metaphoric resonance with Rhonda, and so I was like, okay, I have to come up with a new name for her. So I called my editor one day, and I was like, I need a new name, and I gave her like 15 names. I was like, what do you think about this? And she was like, nah. And so we ended up with Grace, and yes, I did want it to be Grace for, you know, the metaphor of Grace. Champ is actually a little different. I do like Champ for, obviously, the symbolism of Champ, but the real I knew a guy named Champ, and when I was young, and he was actually a terrible guy. Like, he ended up, he's dead now, so rest in peace, but he was like the worst gang member we ever had, but I always liked his nickname. So Champ just started off as me just actually liking someone's nickname, and then I figured out that the name would work because it had that kind of resonance. And then the rest of the characters, yeah, Jude for, you know, obvious reasons, he was Jude, and Kanan and KJ, so yeah, I did pick those. And I think the other thing that I like to do, because I'm always thinking about the acoustics of a sentence, is if you notice, most of the names have one syllable, so that I'm able to manipulate them in a sentence. It's easier for me to do it.
I have a question. Hi, I'm Edie. I know, I'm laughing myself too. So my question is, the thing that I really admired was, you know, you have addiction, which is like this straightforward, repetitive series, and somehow you make it in a, I guess my admiration is for the forward-moving novel that deals with addiction and how you kind of structurally make those converge so incredibly. Just if you wanted to talk about that process. You get the question?
Yeah, I get it. Well, I was talking to a writer last night after the thing, and he was saying that, I forgot this, it was an Asian writer who was saying that he said writing is really working when it was velocity and, oh God, I can't remember the other one. Damn it, I wish I remembered. But I think that one thing that I'm always obviously paying attention to how a sentence sounds. And I think that another thing just with the kind of the diction is that I think I'm strongest when I'm like playing with diction. Like when I'm able to kind of use a neologism or create a portmanteau. So I do like those kind of things where I feel like I'm doing something new-ish. I'm probably never doing anything new, but like to me it feels new-ish. And then I think one of the things that I think kind of I hope, because I don't think it's very much plot in the book, but I think one of the things that might compel someone to keep reading is that every once in a while I think the narrator goes into a kind of confession that maybe propels the person to the next kind of place. So I think one of the quotes that I like is Gordon Lish is a guy I studied with a few years ago, and he said that really kind of hyperbolic, but I still like it. Leave your heart on the page, and people will read to find out how you solve being alive. And so I think that people are always trying to read a fiction writer to see when you're getting a nugget of truth. And as long as you keep kind of feeding that, whether or not it's true or not, then you can compel people to keep going towards the end. And then, you know, the kind of same, the trite, like, writing advice is just to give him something. I tried to give him something that he wanted. I thought the house was big enough for him to just keep going.
Yeah, I actually thought you were so great with plot because you, every time things couldn't get worse, they got worse. And then we mm-hmm. were reading to see how these, you know, all their nobilities would manage in that mm-hmm. situation. Anyway, okay, I could go on.
I have a question, actually, about the split narrative.
Uh-huh.
Maybe, like, when that came about? Like, was it, did you always conceive of this novel as having these two competing perspectives? Mm-hmm. Or did you find that one perspective, if it was Champ or Grace, like, you felt limited, and opening up a new perspective allowed new possibilities into the novel?
It was Champ's in the beginning, and I don't think I felt limited, but I felt not honest about whose story it was. And so I had to kind of really, I had to recognize that it wasn't just Champ's story, and that by giving it all to him, I was missing out on a big chunk of the important conflict. And also that I think I needed that balance, because Champ is so hyper-masculine at times, that I needed someone to kind of counteract him, and then someone to also force him to think about why he was so hyper-masculine. So that's something, and sometimes I slip up and say Rhonda, so if I say Rhonda, you know, I mean, that's something that Grace, I think, was able to do, was to kind of balance Champ, but then also to make the story true. You know, it's not the story of a son, it's the story of a family.
Yeah, I really admired one of the things that you did with Grace was sort of highlighted the unreliable narrator coming from Champ. Like, he's so self-aggrandizing. He would never give you an instance like Grace does when they go bowling and Champ is kind of throwing a fit in the parking lot because he got beat by his mom. So, like,
yeah,
it was stuff like that I really appreciated about the multiple perspectives that you're able to bring in, all these extra things.
Yeah. And then her voice is just a lot more steady, right? It's not any highfalutin diction on Grace. It's just an even, so, you know, it, once you can only be around a hype guy so long.
Speaking of plot, another thing that we talked a lot about in our discussions was sort of whether this story is like sort of like the moment, just like sort of a moment taken out of like sort of a cyclical and like hopeless scenario where it's just like release and relapse and release and relapse and arrest, etc. Or whether there is any hope in the story, even though, you know, the novel ends, it begins and ends in pretty desolate places. Is there potential for change here, or are we just looking at a sort of a family in stasis?
Interesting. I'm working on a new short story, and it's centered around the same kind of characters. And my girlfriend came, she was like, "Why are you always writing about this sad stuff?" And I was like, "It's what I know. It's what I know." I tried to make it realistic to me, but also hopeful. So in the beginning, when the end of the, you know, kind of prologue where they're hugging, and Rhonda, I mean, not see, there I go, and Grace is, you know, she has a little weight on her, and he can't feel her spine anymore, and, you know, to me, that's hope that she'll be clean. And I think that, you know, I think that he is just one of those guys who is just, you know, doing some things that he's not supposed to do. So I would hope that when he got out, he would be able to get his life back on track. I feel like he has a much easier time to break that kind of cycle. And I think, to my, you know, I don't know, you know, this is a semi-autobiographical novel. My mother struggled with drugs for a long time, and I've never asked her, like, when have you stopped, or when is it over? So to my mind, when I was about 15 years old, I had to convince myself that it would never stop. So I had to make peace with that. And so I don't ask that question. I'm not saying that I don't want to know, but I think they're just that exists in my world, that people don't necessarily get all the way clean, even if they have a long stretch of sobriety. So I wanted to be true to that, because that was a really part of my experience.
I wanted to ask a question about process. Mm-hmm. We're going on the autobiographical tangent.
Yeah.
interviews, you said that you had asked a couple of people for permissions on what they might include, because you don't want to, show their guilt or innocence in a way that they wouldn't be all right with.
Mm-hmm.
And I was curious to know how that affected the writing process, and had that permission not been granted, what the effect would be.
Well, I can't remember if I asked some people, but what I did was I didn't want to include, well, when I was thinking, you know, it'd be closer to real autobiography, I was going to use, you know, closer names and descriptions, who, if you were in that city, you would really know who that person was. But there was really no benefit of that, because it's not really whether or not this is an actual person, it's just whether or not you believe that this type of person exists in this predicament. And so I didn't really, it just so happens most of those people are locked up anyway, but I didn't really kind of, towards the end of it, I wasn't really thinking about that. I had gone so far into the realm of fiction that wasn't a concern, but really early on when I first started writing, I was concerned with that. And I think a guy, matter of fact, there's a guy who wrote this really good essay too. It's called Too Poor for Pop Culture. He just published it last week on Salon. And he emailed me, he said, I'm reading your book, man. He said, I'm thinking of changing my memoir to fiction. He's like, I'm writing about 16 murders. And I was like, ooh, you should write fiction. Are those open cases we're talking about? Or, you know, like, you want to be mindful that, you know, though you may live in the literary world, other people are living in different worlds, and you might have to face some consequences from the other world.
Want to open it up for some questions? Who wants to jump in?
What surprised you most about the reception of the book?
Ooh. I think what surprised me most was I don't know. I mean, I think the Times review was surprising to me because they didn't think it was going to happen. I was trying to remain hopeful. And when I first read it, I didn't know how to take it. Like, I got it on my birthday, and I read it, and I was like, this is kind of cool. And then my editor hit me back. She was like, that's the best review I've ever seen. I was like, oh, okay, well, maybe I need to read it again. I need to be more happy about this. But I think just the overall experience is both heartening and then disappointing, right? So for every, you know, one great thing that happens, there were 12 disappointments that I experienced before that. So I think that's probably the most, when I recount this experience, it'll be like, yeah, there were some great things that happened, but I also will remember those things that didn't happen.
Were you surprised that most people writing reviews were sort of fixated on the issues of race and poverty, when whenever you would address those claims, you always brought it back to family and friends.
Well, I think you can't really predict what is going to be the kind of the hook for a reader, but I would hope that when they came to what I really wanted people to appreciate was I wanted people to like see that these people are human, and that this could be a real story, and I also wanted people to respect what I'd done as a writer. So the craftsmanship of the work is really, like, if someone had just said, I hate that book, but I love the sentences, I'd be like, cool, right on. Because ultimately, like, you know, I could have wrote this story 15 years ago, like, this, the basic story of this, but I could not have wrote those sentences 15 years ago. And so that really, to me, is like the evolution of the process of writing. And that's what I'm most proud of, is that I can write now, not that I can tell this story, because I had this story 20 years ago.
One of the things, I mean, this is sort of not a great segue off of Dan's question, but one of the things that I found particularly interesting in the book is that sometimes you do raise characters when they are, it's very important to know, you know, that Jude is white, and
mm-hmm.
or the Jeff who goes into the barber shop is white. We need to know this. But there are a lot of other situations where you don't race characters. Mm-hmm. Sort of like leave it to, like, you put other clues in that mm-hmm. you leave it up to the readers to make these assumptions. It actually reminded me a lot of Recitatif, the Toni Morrison's short story in that way. Mm-hmm. Like in the scenes with in the classroom after Champ gives his speech, we don't find out. You don't tell us the race of the professor or the two students who are like, I'm not prejudiced, but mm-hmm. but you tell us like what they're wearing, and you know, some guy's clothes are too tight, another girl's wearing like really dirty looking boots, and you know, the professor's wearing like an African print shirt, and like, so I was wondering if that was like a conscientious decision that you made, that you'd want to leave that less explicit.
Yeah, I did want to leave that less explicit, and you know, though he makes several comments about race, I do think he also recognizes that it would be really foolish for him to across the board categorize, you know, white people are doing him wrong. I mean, he's in college, and to get there, people had to have done really nice things for him. But he also recognizes that, you know, like in the beginning when the police officers come, are they white? I don't know, but they are kind to him in a way that you wouldn't expect from a police officer. So I do think that they're just, I want to be really careful about stereotyping, but also highlighting stereotypes, if that makes sense. Like, I do want to say that, yeah, they exist, and they exist in Portland, yes, but also that you have to be smart enough to know that there's nuance in these categories.
Can you talk a little bit about the way that the reproduced forms and the epigraphs at the front of each chapter work in the novel?
Yeah. So I didn't want to have chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I was thinking, well, how can I demarcate when one chapter ends and begins? And I thought that the dialogue was another kind of piece to propel you through that chapter, at least until you got to where the dialogue was. You're like, oh, well, I had to find out what's the context for this. So to me, it was the dialogue prologues at the beginning of every chapter are really kind of plotting devices to propel a reader through a chapter. And what I wanted to do with the forms was to, originally those forms were filled out. I had people fill them out. I had my mom fill out the custody thing and all that. But then I thought that they had more impact as blank pages. And I wanted them to also foretell what was going to happen in that section of the book. So if you notice, like, the church form comes before she gets saved. The last form is a police report, which kind of, you know, shows that something is going to happen with the law. So I thought those were also plotting devices, but also in a symbolic way, kind of show the forces that are operating in that neighborhood.
Do you guys have any other questions?
What's up in the back?
Yeah, one more. Another thing I found interesting was the use of the AA adages or the aphorisms or the church proverbs. Mm-hmm. And for me, as I was reading it initially, these kind of things, when they pop up in the novel, juxtaposed against the really difficult situation of the characters, they just felt so empty and vapid and ineffectual. Mm-hmm. And then when you get to the end of the novel, you have this litany of all these phrases put together, the same ones that we've already read, mm-hmm. and they've taken on a completely new meaning. It's really empowering and powerful, and I just wanted to know whether or not, or what was your, you know, what were you hoping to achieve with that last litany of are you trying to say that, were you trying to say that these things are still ineffectual, or are you trying to say sort of like in AA where you say these things over and over again, and it's only until you hit really rock bottom that they take on, you know, real meaning?
I think both. Right, because she says them to herself when she's in a moment of insecurity, and they seem to have very little effect on the outcome of whatever she's insecure about. And then at the end, I think, what more insecurity can it be for her to be back in a drug program? So she is insecure, but at the same time, maybe that litany is the thing that's going to save her this time. It's just, you know, I think with addiction, you just never know when the last time is going to be the last time, right? And I think that's really what she's struggling with. I don't even know if Grace is ever clean again, but I do know that she hopes she'll be clean again, and, you know, maybe those affirmations are enough to get her through this program one more time, to get her on that wall of champions.
Thank you.
Right. That's probably a great last line to close on. But you have a class to teach, right?
Yeah, I'm good. I have I got like 5 more minutes. We had 7 minutes of tech difficulties.
Well,
I had a question about, I wanted to ask you about the title, because from the outset I had an idea of how to read what the residue years might mean.
Okay.
In text, it kind of gave me a different idea. So when I was approaching it, I had the idea that the residue years was the what you leave behind as you go forward. But when Mister says, most of us, if we're lucky, we see only a few seconds of the high life and the rest are the residue years, it makes it seem as if the residue years are what we are constantly having to wade through. To what extent do you feel that is one, the other, or both?
So I think I didn't tell you where I got the residue years from. So I got it from reading this GQ article on Mark Jacobs. And Mark Jacobs was talking about his addiction. And he said, they asked him a question. He said, those were the residue years in my life. And I said, oh, residue years. And so the term residue always resonated with me. And I really wasn't trying to make that rhyme. Because when I was in another life and I used to sit in drug houses when I was in my teens, when an addict would come in and they would smoke whatever they had, and they would get down to their last, they would scrape the pipe for the resin. And I used to think, like, that has to be the lowest of the lowest. Like, not only are you on dope and in a dope house, but you don't have any more and you're scraping what isn't even dope left to still get high. To me, so that term and all of the kind of other words that come from it are represent to me like rock bottom for an addict. And so to me, that's a part of who Rhonda is. And then I think for Champ, I have an uncle who in the 1980s was like the biggest drug dealer in Oregon. He was so big, they wrote an article on him when he got popped in that said Superman goes to jail. But if you see him now, he's like, I don't know if he's on drugs, but he's definitely been on drugs for many, many years, and he doesn't work, and he goes to prison like every 2 or 3 years for a year or two. And so I think about him, and I'm like, he really represents that life. Like, there are no retirement plans for hustlers. And so to me, he got a few moments of the high life, and everything else is residue. And so that's how, to me, it speaks to Champ. Like, he could very well become. So there's a line in there, I think, that Champ says something about Mister. Like, he's the best you can hope for or your worst kind of nightmare, right? 50 years or 20 or 30 years hustling is a dream, really, because you made it. But then also, like, you've been hustling for 30 years. So I really wanted to speak to both of them, Rhonda and the addiction and how low that brings you, and then also Champ, who could very well fall into this is his high life now, and he has 50 more years of residue.
Maybe as a last question, I wanted to ask, because I felt like this was like a very politically aware novel, you know, which not to say that it's any less literary or, you know, full of narrative and feeling, etc. Sort of, how do you think about your life as a writer in terms of like social justice, or do you even think about your life in terms of
overtly political in the sense that, you know, you'll see me campaigning for someone or attending a forum on some budget cuts, but I also think of my politics as like social activism. So I do think it's important. One, when I talked about kind of empowering people through the language, like it's a certain amount of resistance. Like, to me, giving that to someone is political. Like, taking a young kid who doesn't have the language to kind of explain what he's going through and giving him that language is empowering him. And to me, that's the kind of politics that I gravitate towards, rather than, you know, are they going to change the mandatory minimums for a felon in possession? So I try not to be involved in politics in that way, but I do believe on a grassroots kind of social level that I have to be involved because I'm a product of that.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks for the invite, you guys.
We hope to bring you up here, you know, in person.
That'll be great. All right. Okay. All right.
See ya. Thank you.
Now we can just watch ourselves and kind of post it.